Okay, so let's start. If you have questions, you can ask the students, okay? You can interrupt as yesterday, and then we can discuss also some questions. So definition. So X is a set, again. Just a set. Subbasis now. So we define topology and basis, now subbasis, for a topology on X, for a topology on X. Topology abbreviate on X is a collection. So all this S written now, it's S written. It's a collection S of subsets. Of X, and now we have three conditions for topology, two conditions for basis. Here's just one condition, almost trivial condition. It's a collection of subsets of X whose union is X. So we want all points in some of these elements. So that's the definition of a subbasis, very easy. Almost everything is a subbasis. The only condition, union is X. So we have a subbasis, S. So what we do? We go to a basis. How? We take all finite intersections. We take all finite intersections of elements of S, and that is a basis. Why is that a basis? Well, the first condition of a basis says any element is in some basis element, because then, of course, we have S contained in B. Now that's okay. So the union is X, so the union of the basis element is also X. So the first condition is trivial. Then the second condition for a basis is if you have two basis elements and a point in the intersection, we need a third one, which contains a point, is contained in the intersection. But in this case, this is trivial because if you have a finite intersection, another finite intersection, and takes the intersection, that's again a basis element. That's a finite intersection. So in this case, we can take B3, the third one, just as the intersection of B1 and B2. That happens sometimes, okay? Not always, but sometimes that happens. So this is the basis. That's clear. And then we know how to go to the topology. How do we go? We take all arbitrary unions. And then we got the topology. Here's a basis, here's a subbasis. And T is called the topology generated by the subbasis, of course. The topology generated by the subbasis. The topology generated by the subbasis. So these are standard ways to define topologies. Basis, frequently, sometimes subbasis, and sometimes immediately the topology definition. So, okay, now we do many other examples. So the order topology. So the first week are examples, the order topology. We will prove some interesting theorems, and we will see very interesting examples, but not this week. This is a formal approach now, the order topology. So what is this? Which is important in many examples, will be important. So X is a simply ordered set. So let X, we start with a, be a simply. So there are other words. Instead of simply, we may say linearly or totally ordered set. That is, what does it mean? It's complete order, completely ordered set. That's another, still another word. So if X, we can compare all elements. If X and Y are in X, then we have X smaller than Y, or y smaller than x. Well, that's not completely true, because they might be equal. We don't want, anyway, so x different from y here. Because this means smaller, not smaller equal. This means smaller. So if x, y, x, x different than y, and we don't want, so x smaller than x does not hold. That is forbidden by definition. So this is what we don't want. We can compare all elements. And this is, so what is the other possibility, which is also important? It's called partial order. So we have a total order, or complete order, or linear order. I forgot what's the book, but it doesn't matter. It's clear. There are many words here. And then we have partial order. But we will always, if we take ordered set, we mean always this kind. And then we have, the important thing is, how is it called? I forgot. So if x also, the important thing is, if x is smaller than y, y is smaller, this is smaller than z, then x is smaller than z. So that is the condition. Important condition for an order. So we have x with an order. Okay, and then we have a topology, the order topology. So B, let B, so we define a basis. That's like the real numbers. We take all open intervals. So all open intervals. So AB in X, A is smaller than B. So this is open intervals, open interval. It's like the reals. So all open intervals. But in general, maybe this is not a topology, because we want each element to be in some open set, in some basis element. So what? So we have to add something. So A0, closed interval, B in X, if X has the smallest element. A0. Then we have to add these half open intervals. These are the elements which contain A0. Here, they are, A0 is not. And then the same, of course, for the if there's the largest element. A in B, A in X, if X has the largest element. Then we have to add these half open intervals, largest element, which is B0. Then B is the basis. Now B is the basis. So this is trivial. That's like for the reals that we did yesterday. So you just look intersection of basis elements. Then B is the basis, which generates, and this is the order topology. The order topology. That's the name, the order topology. Of course, associated to the given order. Associated to the given order. Other order, maybe other topology. Well, maybe same, it's not clear. Associated to the given. To the given order, to the fixed or given order. That's the definition of the order topology. For example, the main example, of course, the standard topology. Well, I don't write that. The standard, it's clear. the standard topology on the reals. That's the order topology. For the standard order, of course. Okay, that's clear. That's a model. Here's a strange example. But it will be important later. Not exactly this, but something similar. So we take R cross R. Reals times reals. There's no order at first sight, except there's one order. There is an order. So we take R cross R with, how is it called in the book? With dictionary or lexicographic. Let me see. It's dictionary or lexicographic, with dictionary order. Oh, mommy, lexicographic order, lexicographic order, which is the same. So how is it defined? So the elements of R cross R, we write x1 times y1. X1 times y1, first coordinate, second coordinate. In the book, he doesn't write, so the alternative, don't write that. The alternative would be this. To write this. However, this is also an interval, open interval. So in the whole book, this is an open interval, but this is x1 times y1 as element of a product. Right. So it's smaller than x2 cross y2. So what is dictionary order? Dictionary order. You look at the first letter. That's the first coordinate. So if x1 is smaller than x2, then it comes first. Or x1 might be equal to x2, and then you look at the second letter, and y1 is smaller than y2. So we may take also more coordinates than we have the dictionary order, okay? We take two. So this is the order, the dictionary order. And then we have a topology. So this gives the dictionary order topology. Dictionary order topology on R cross R. So let's see what is the basis. All open intervals, all open intervals. So here's R cross R. So we make a picture. It's very easy. This is not so interesting, but there will be a space defined similarly, which is one of the main examples of the book. So this will be important. So we take two points, this one and this one. So this is larger than this, because the first coordinate is larger. So the open interval from this point to this point are all points larger than all these, this kind of stuff. And then where does it finish? It finishes here. And then we are out. So this, all these points between, as I, that's open interval. There's a second possibility. If you have two points and they have the same first coordinate, then the interval is really an interval. So this is open interval and this is another open interval. And as you notice, for the second, this type of interval suffice to generate the topology. So these intervals suffice, are a basis for the topology, suffice to generate the topology. We don't need these. This is sufficient. Why? To generate the topology. These are sufficient. Why is that? Because if you have these, then we have these. If you take a point here, we have clearly one of these, which contains the point is contained here, or here, or here, okay? So if you have these intervals, then This is a union of these intervals. So then we have also this. And then we have everything. So this is a dictionary order topology on, which is not too interesting. We will see it again today. It has another description. But a modification of this will be one of the main examples of the book. So this is important, the dictionary order. Maybe not on R cross R, but OK. So now, maybe I should go always in order. So I restart here. So the next example, product, yes, or subspace. Well, first product, then subspace. So product topology. Many easy examples, abstract constructions. What did I say? The product topology on X cross Y. So this we will define, the product topology. So now X and Y are topological spaces. We have a topology already on X and on Y. So these are topological spaces. So the definition, so we take a basis, B. So we take all products, U times V, U open in X, and V open in Y. All these products, open times open. So open, whatever, rectangles. So this is a basis. Well, that's okay. I mean, you just make a small picture here. If you have the intersection of two basis elements, so this is a product, U times V. Here's another product, U times V. It might be empty. If it's empty, no condition. If it's not empty, it's again a product. U1 times V1 intersection U2 times V2 is equal to U1 intersection U2 times V1 intersection V2, okay? So it's a basis which generates, and this is the definition of the product topology, which generates the product topology. That's the definition on X cross Y. That's the product topology. The definition of the product topology. So this. So there's a small lemma, very trivial. All, everything is very formal. No, it gets less formal later. So lemma says, if B is a basis for X, for the topology of X, B generates and so I take the notation of the book, and C is a basis for Y, then we have a basis which is called D in the book, D. So we take B times C, we take products like here. We take products of basis elements where B is a basis element in B and C is a basis element in the other basis, C. So we take not all products of open sets, but only of basis elements. Then this is the basis of the product topology. In general, smaller than this basis. It's a basis for the product topology. That's a lemma. So I will not prove all these things, but let's prove this one. It's very easy. However, one has to write in a ordered way everything here. So, proof. Let's prove. So we apply what we called yesterday. So I gave a name. Forgot the name. Basis recognition theorem. Apply the basis. I like this name. The basis recognition. Well, it was a lemma or theorem sometimes. I don't know, whatever. So we apply the basis recognition theorem, which we proved yesterday. So what does it say? We take an open set. So let W be open. W be open in X cross Y. And we take a point in W. And X cross Y in W. So we take an open set and a point. We have to find an element of D which contains the point and is contained in the open set. Then the basis recognition lemma says that this is a basis, it is a basis, and it generates the topology which we want. That's part of this basis recognition lemma. Okay? So we have X cross Y and Y, and this is open. So, by the definition, so I do it very carefully. By the definition of the product topology, there is an element, a basis element, U cross V in the basis B, no? Such that X cross Y is in U cross V, is contained in W. Because the basis B generates the product topology. So that means, given an open set, given a point, there's a basis element which contains a point, is contained in the open set. So X is in Y, X is in U, X is in U and Y is in V. And these are open. So, but we have a basis for X, for the topology, and the basis for... So there exist basis elements. So how to call that? C, probably. Let me see. I don't want to change the notion in the book. Yes. No, B and B. First B, of course. There's B, a basis element in the basis B, and the basis element C in the basis C, such that X is in B, contained in U, because this is open in X. And Y is contained in C, contained in V, because this is open in Y. And we have a basis. And then we have X cross Y is contained in C cross D, which is contained in U cross V, which is contained in W. So what? So this is an element of the basis which we called, how did we call that? D. So this is D. This is an element of the basis which was the original basis, B, yes. That was B. So now by this theorem, basis recognition lemma or theorem implies now that D is a basis for the product topology X cross Y. More or less, if you have to write a proof of this, you have to write this, okay? That may be an exercise in an exam, an easy exercise. And then you write something like this. You use definitions and so on and so on.
Should be B cross C or C cross or
C cross D, is this okay? B cross C. Thank you.
Excuse me, professor, we use a written...
One second. So B cross C, everybody, okay. That's the main point. One has to concentrate on the symbols, okay? That's the main difficulty almost, to have control over the symbols. So here I was not concentrated. So it's B times C contained in U cross V. Yes, other question?
Yes, we use the written P with two meanings. It's the basis of X, and we said that's U cross V and P, which is not...
In two meanings? No. Where is... D is this one, okay? Let's see. Yeah, Vanessa will check everything. D, this is the definition of D, okay? Basis element times basis element.
Okay.
And now I have a basis. The basis for X is called B. Maybe B I have two times. Yes. You're right. B. Yeah, right. So let B. This B is two times here. Okay? That's what you say, right?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Because here it's the basis for the product topology, no? And here it's the basis for X. So this is, I use this in the book. So.
We can use B prime or something.
Yes, I have to change something. I don't know what the book does. Then I will not change the proof. Then I call this prime here, okay? It's not so nice, but. And then which one is prime? This one, right? This one is in the prime. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you. I always have problems with the letters, okay? So sometimes they are two times. Then one has to correct and to check everything again. So definition, the standard topology in R2. R2, which is R cross R. Is by definition is a product topology. By definition, where each R of each factor R has a standard topology, no? So we have the standard topology, and then the standard here is the product topology. Okay, so a basis for the product topology is open interval times open interval, okay? So a basis for the product topology, for the standard topology, which is the product topology, the basis for the standard topology in R cross R is AB times CD. So this, all these, these are products of open intervals. All products of open intervals. So these are open rectangles, okay? Open rectangles in R2. That's by definition the product topology, the standard topology in R2. It's a product topology. And the basis is, so we use the lemma already, okay? We take, in general, we have to take open times open, but we can take a basis here, open intervals times open intervals. So these are easy to describe. And then, we have this example here. We have two topologies. Here's another topology on R2. We have also the dictionary topology on R, another topology. So what is the relation between these topologies? So here's the standard on R2. And here's a dictionary order on R2, all right? So we have two
We cannot compare these topologies. We cannot compare two topology.
Well, let's see if we can compare or not compare. So you say they are not comparable. I would say they are comparable. So let's take a basis element. So we use what I called yesterday to compare topologies. I called it the topology comparison theorem. I call it now the basis or topology. Yesterday I write basis, but topology. But I prefer basis, comparison. Lemma, yesterday, okay? I changed name. It's not used in the book anyway. The basis comparison lemma. We have two bases. We work with two bases and we compare the topologies. I give these two names. They are not in the book. The basis recognition lemma and the basis comparison lemma. Okay, so what we do? We take a basis element for the product topology. What is this? This is an open rectangle, right? So this is basis element of the product topology. So an open rectangle. So this is an open rectangle. Then we take any point. And now we find a basis element of the other topology. What are the bases? So we take here this point, and the interval is this one. This is the interval, right? So this is a basis element of the dictionary order topology. Right? That's the second type. The first type, the second type. The first type we don't need, but these are. So this implies then, what does this imply, this picture? This says that the dictionary order topology is finer than the standard. So they are comparable. Somebody said they are not comparable. They are comparable, okay? So this implies the dictionary order topology on R2 is finer than the standard topology. Do you agree?
If it's finer, doesn't that mean that the open sets of the dictionary of R2, of the standard topology, are also open sets of the dictionary topology?
The open sets in the standard are open in the dictionary, okay?
Yeah, is this true?
Yes, that is. We take a basis element of the standard, and we take a point, then we find the basis element of the dictionary, which contains the point, is contained here. Then this, how did we call it? The basis comparison theorem, or topology comparison theorem, says that the dictionary is finer than the standard, okay? So they are comparable. However, this is not the whole story. So maybe they are equal. If they are equal, we should go in the other direction. So we take, so this is the basis element. We should of the dictionary order topology. Okay. This is the basis element of the dictionary order topology. And now we take a point here. And by the basis comparison theorem, I should be able to find the basis element now of the standard topology, which contains the points contained here. But these are open rectangles. It's impossible. So open rectangle looks like this. So this is never contained here. So this picture implies it's strictly finer. The dictionary order. Topology. It's finer, but it's strictly finer. Is strictly finer. Then the standard topper. It's strictly finer.
Professor, if we consider
one second, it's finer. Where's finer here?
Discrete topology. Order. What is upper?
It's finer. Say again, what?
If we consider Y in the discrete topology.
Yeah, that's a good question. I come back to that in 10 minutes, okay? Wait. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, in 10 minutes, 5 minutes. So this means this is a basis element of the dictionary topology, not open in the standard. Now, this is not open in the standard. It's clear. I mean, this is analysis, no, of the plane. And if you have this, this is not open in the plane, in the analysis, in the standard. No, it's completely not open in the standard. So the dictionary is larger. Okay, we come back to this. That's a good point. I mean, I say that the dictionary order topology in R cross R, the standard is important. The dictionary in R cross R is not so interesting. We will see in 5 minutes. However, we modify. We don't take the whole reals, but we take the interval times interval. And then it becomes very interesting. That we will see. Not today. So I continue here. The next point is the subspace topology. Ah, no, I'm sorry. Yes, I already did. So what you are saying is that so we take the product topology. Sorry. You are right. I can do it now. The product topology on R cross R. And here I take the standard. No, here I take the standard. And here I take the discrete topology.
Professor, the camera isn't moving.
Sorry?
The camera is not moving with you. It's working again.
Well, the technician, do you hear me?
It's okay now.
It's moving now?
Yes.
Yes, professor.
Do you see this?
Yes.
Okay.
It's okay.
Yeah, you should, if there's a problem, you interrupt, okay? So I take the product topology in R cross R, but now I don't take standard times standard, standard, but I take discrete and standard, okay? So what topology is this? So we get a basis. So what is the basis here? Standard topology, basis are open intervals, right? That's the basis of the standard topology, AB. That's the standard. Now I ask you, what is the basis, what is the most efficient basis for the discrete topology?
Point. Singletons.
Singletons, exactly. So this is the basis, one-point sets, singletons. So on the product, I take basis times basis. So a basis for the product topology here now. So a basis for this product topology. What is it? It's basis times basis. So here we have singletons, x. Okay, single points. X in R. That's the basis for the discrete topology. So a basis for the product topology, for this product topology, is a basis times basis. But this is exactly the basis elements for the, so this is the interval X cross A, X cross B. So this is this picture, no? We have exactly this. Here's X, here's A, here's B coordinate, first coordinate, second coordinate. So, so we get exactly these intervals. So a basis for the product of is this, which is the basis for the dictionary, which is the basis. This is the basis for the dictionary order topology on R cross R. So we may define it in a much easier way. We don't need the order. We don't need the order. We take just the product where this is a standard and this is a discrete topology. And then we have this the same topology, the dictionary. That's an easier definition, okay? I suppose somebody made some remark and this was more or less this remark, right? Somebody of you talked about the discrete. Okay.
Yes.
That's this point, right? Exactly. Okay. Now I take the subspace topology. Another easy construction, the subspace topology.
Excuse me, Professor, the camera is not moving again.
Yes.
Yes, it's okay now.
Okay. Do you see this now? Yes.
Yes, Professor. We see it.
Yes or no? I be more clear.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, that's okay. That's nice. So X is a topological space. We have a topology, and we have a subset, which is called A in general. Let me use the notation of the book. Where is it? Here it is, subspace topology. X and Y is subset. Well, anyway. Yes, Y or A. And Y in X is subset. We have a subset. And we want a topology on Y now. And now TY, topological space, X with a topology T. In general, we don't write a topology. But maybe now we write one. X with a topology T and Y a subset. Then we have a topology on Y, TY. Then we take an open set in X and intersect with Y. Where U is open, U is in T. So U is open in it. So we take all these intersections. And this is already a topology on Y. It's a topology. So one, it's very easy to check the conditions. This is set theory, intersections, unions, and so on. So I will not write this. It's a topology on Y. And this is the subspace topology. That's the definition, the subspace topology. That's the definition of the subspace topology. If you want to see the proof, somebody can say, you have to prove that. Then I will prove it. But otherwise, I will not prove it, because it's set theory. So, now again the same type of lemma, which we did for the subspace. So here's the lemma. So let B be a basis for X. And we have this subset, Y subset, as before. Then BY is equal to, now what we do? Here we take all intersections of open sets with Y. Now we take just basis elements. So B intersection Y, B in B, is the basis for the subspace topology. Proof exercise. It's similar as the proof of the lemma before, okay? It's completely analogous, similar as the proof of the lemma before. The corresponding lemma for the product topology, no? Here we have the subspace, but the proof is the same for the product topology. So, exercise. Easy exercise, very easy exercise. You just imitate the proof. And then I have another exercise, which I will not prove also. This is, we can compare, compare two topologies. So exercise. Let A be a subspace of X. So this means A is a subset with a subspace topology. No, that means subspace of X. No, that means so A in X is a subset with a subspace topology. This is a subspace with a subspace topology. So then we call it a subset, subspace. Sorry. Let A be a subspace of X and B a subset, a subspace, also subset, but the topology, subspace of Y. Then we have two topologies on A times B. Okay, then there are two topologies. On the product, A times B. Which are the two topologies? Well, the subspace is the product topology. The product topology. So A is a topological space, subspace. It's a space. And B is a space, so we have the product topology. Then there are two topologies on A plus B, the product topology and the subspace topology. The subspace topology, A times B as a subspace of X cross Y. Where X cross Y has a product topology. No, X cross Y has a product topology. So first, what we take So we sort of commute the construction. First we take subspace, and then product topology. Here we take subspace, and here the product topology, okay? So we commute the two stuff. And there are two topologies, and these two topologies are the same, which are equal. These two topologies are the same. Are equal. They coincide. Okay? That's the exercise. Now, this is an easy exercise, but you should be able to write it in a nice way. That's the point. You work with Bayes, probably, and you compare, and you show that these two topologies have the same have a common basis, and then they are equal. Prove they have a common basis. The point is to write this in a nice ordered way, or in a nice organized way. Okay, that's the point, right? So this is an exercise. It's also a proof, a theorem in the book, but without proof, I suppose. Maybe there's a proof. Then you can just write the proof. I think there's no proof in the book, but it's a theorem in the book. Okay. So this is an exercise that you may see in a written exam, this cut. I had some other exercise before today, you know. This lemma, very, well, in general, easy exercises. So now these are examples. So we have seen many examples. And now we take about closed sets and limit points. Closed sets and limit points. Another basic, small basic chapter at limit points. So what means closed? Closed is complement of open. So a subset A, a subset A of a topological space X, a subset A of a topological space X is closed if its complement is open. Well, that's analysis, no? It's complement that you know from analysis anyway. If it's complement, X minus A is open. Okay? The subset of topological space is closed if it's complement. That's a definition. Then, there's the three conditions, the empty set and, what is it? X is, are closed. Now the second condition is that, so arbitrary unions of open sets are open. So arbitrary unions of closed sets are closed.
Intersections, no unions.
What?
Intersections, no unions. Intersection, no union, not union.
Thank you. After intersections of closed sets are closed. Yes, thank you. One has to concentrate, right? And then finite unions of open of closed sets are closed. Proof, which I'm not right. These are the two De Morgan's laws, okay, which we saw yesterday. You take complements. Take complements. A and use De Morgan's, which we saw yesterday, so I will not repeat this, laws. There are two, one for this and the other for this. So you reduce it to the open case. You pass from closed to open and use De Morgan, and then it's easy. So this is completely equivalent. I mean, topology might be used defining closed sets instead of open. These are just names, open, closed. Maybe not just names, because one has some intuition is open and some intuition is closed. So here's another small proposition. I pass now to this one. I go in this direction. Otherwise, I get confused. So, proposition, maybe lemma, proposition. Let Y be a subspace of X. So it's a subset of X with a subspace topology. So let Y be a subspace of X. Then a subset A of Y. Well, of Y, doesn't matter. It's closed in Y if and only if let me abbreviate in this way. Then the subset A of Y is closed in Y if and only if A is the intersection of a closed set in X with what is the sub with Y. So A is the intersection of a closed set C in Y, in X, sorry, in the whole space with Y. So I will not prove this also. Proof. So this is very easy to remember, of course. If you have a subspace, what are the open sets? We have a subspace. What are the open sets in the subspace? These are intersections of open sets in X with Y. And this says, what are the closed sets? Well, these are intersections of closed sets in X with Y. So it's very analogous, okay? So take complements. This is set theory. Take complements to pass, well, yeah. To pass from open to closed and in the other direction. Because I want now to, there becomes the first interesting point. Now, first I define the interior. So, of course, the proof here is in the book, but it's four lines. One has to concentrate on these proofs. But because the symbols have to be okay and so on, and but so definition. I'm going fast in this first week because the interesting points, this is very formal. We have few examples, but we will see examples, of course. But we need more interesting situations. So definition. So let A be a subset. Subset of a topological space X. Then we have the interior and the closure. So that's also known from analysis. So we define the interior of A. This is the interior of A. So this is the union over all open sets in X. U is open in X. Sorry. So U is open in X. And is contained, U is contained in the in A, and U is contained in A. So this is the union of open sets, all open sets contained in A. So this is clear, so this is open, then this is clearly open. Union of open sets. And it's the largest open set contained in A. No, that's what it is. The largest open set. The largest open set contained in, clearly, contained in A. That's the interior. On the other hand, we have the closure. So this is a closure. The interior of A in X, no? If you want. Not in A. A is open in A, no? Every space is open in itself. It's closed in itself, no? So the interior of A in X. And this is the closure of A in X, no? The closure. So how? Intersection? Of all C. So I write in a similar way. I have to look where's the interior. Where's the interior? Interior, interior. Oh, it's here. It's so now the intersection of all C, where C is closed, it's open in X. No, you may add, of course. Oh, no, that's here. Anyway, sorry. U is open in X and U contained A. C is closed in X. And now what? And A is contained in C. So this is an arbitrary intersection of closed sets. So this is closed. Then the closure is closed in X. It's closed, well, in X, yes. And, of course, it is the smallest closed set which contains how is it called? A. That's a closure. The smallest closed set which contains A. And the interior is the largest open set, which is contained in A. Okay, so these are the two definitions. And it makes no sense to talk about the, for example, you can meditate about that. The smallest, to change words here, the smallest closed set, the largest closed set contained in A is not well defined. Okay, so these are well defined. Because arbitrary unions of open sets are open, arbitrary intersections of closed sets are closed. If you change the words and you take here open sets, then arbitrary intersection of open sets is not open in general. So the largest open set which contains A is not well defined. In general, it's not well defined. So another proposition. Let Y be a subspace of X. And A Then the closure of A in Y what is A? A subset of Y, I forgot to write. Let Y be a subspace of A and A contained in Y, so a subset of Y, then the closure of A in Y, this is a subspace, is equal to so it takes a closure of A, but this is the closure of A in the large space always. If I write A bar, it's the closure of A in the larger space, X. So here we need the closure of A in Y and the closure of A in X. This is the closure of A in X. Here we need another symbol. Closure of A in X is equal to Then the closure of A in Y is equal to A intersection Y, yes. So how do you get the closure? You take the closure in the large space X and then you intersect with this subspace. And then that's the closure of A in the subspace. Okay, that's a proposition. I will not prove this also. So these are all the same kind of set theoretical proofs, okay? Because I want to come to a more interesting point already today. Let's see. How to find the closure first? How to find the closure? This closure. Well, you want all closed sets which contain A. That's somewhat messy now to find all closed sets and then intersect. So maybe we need a better criterion. Yes. So. So this is, in the book, it's even a theorem, but it's easy, but it's theorem. So let A be a subset of X. Of a topological space X. So there are always two things which we may write. A is subset of X. But X is a topological space, so A is subspace of X. Okay? That depends what we want. Here we are not interested in the subspace, but in the subset. If you are interested in the subspace, like here, Then we write subspace. Subspace is first of all a subset. Okay. So sometimes we say subset, sometimes we say subspace. Let A be a subset of a topological space X. So I. And X in X. Let's take a point X in X. Then X is in the closure of A. We want to construct the closure. X is a point in the closure of A if and only if. If and only if. So the closure, the definition was here, no? X, a point X is in the closure of A if and only if every neighborhood. And now I introduce a very convenient way to talk. Every neighborhood, difficult to write. I don't know even if this is the right spelling, because neighborhood, yeah, I suppose. Sometimes it's different in English and in British and American English. Every neighborhood U of X. What is a neighborhood? So I have to define, I will use this word, neighborhood, and I will abbreviate neighborhood. Because this is difficult to write, okay? So neighborhood, neighborhood. Every neighborhood U of X, and neighborhood means open set containing X. An open set, that's neighborhood. It's not always the same. You have to look in the book. Sometimes it's an open set containing X. That's a neighborhood for us. The book doesn't use this word, but it's very convenient. An open set containing X, that's a neighborhood. Sometimes a neighborhood must not be open. That means it's a neighborhood means the point is contained in the interior. So there's an open set containing the point contained in the set, okay? But for our choice will be in this, a neighborhood is open, an open set containing, that's a neighborhood. For me, so I will use this because it's very convenient. Every neighborhood of U of X intersects A. That means a U intersection A is not empty. So that's how to find the closure. We check all points. Which points? So here we have to check every neighborhood, but the neighborhood we see in general. So this is 2i. This is first. And in 2i we have a basis. Suppose B is a basis. Sorry. So suppose B is a basis. Of what is our space? X. Always X. Suppose B is the basis of X, then X, then X is in the closure of A, if and only if. Every neighborhood of X in B, no, in the basis, not arbitrary, but every neighborhood. Every element of B, that's a basis, containing X. Intersects. Intersects. What is our A? Yes. So here we have to check all neighborhoods, every neighborhood. U intersects A, and here we just check for elements of a basis which contain X, okay? So the basis If it's okay for basis, it's okay. So proof. I will prove I. So if X is not in A bar, suppose X is not in the closure of A, then X minus the closure of A is open. It's a complement of a closed set. So it's open. So it's a neighborhood of X. So this is the neighborhood of X, which does not intersect A, obviously, because A is contained here, which does not intersect A. Okay, proving, that proves something here. What prove it? Proving, so if X is not, then it's a neighborhood which does not intersect. So if every neighborhood intersects A, then X is in the closure. So which direction is it? If every neighborhood intersects A, then X is in the closure. So we go in this direction, proving this direction. Okay, that proves this direction, right? For the other direction, let U be a neighborhood which does not intersect A. Let U be a neighborhood. That's neighborhood of X. Suppose there's a neighborhood of X which does not intersect A. Let U be a neighborhood of X which does not intersect A. Then X minus U is closed. It's complement of an open set, so these are the closed sets. And does not contain X. Because X is in U, and does not contain X. Clearly. What is the conclusion now? So X is not in the closure of A. And this implies
X minus U contained A.
Sorry? What is the closure of A? The closure of A, sorry, what is the closure of A? We need the definition here. Now, the closure of A is the intersection of all closed sets which contain A.
Here, X minus U contains A.
Yeah, I have to write something now.
We use this fact.
Sorry, it's very... Then
we have to use this fact. X minus U contains A. And it is closed set.
You say this, right?
Yes.
Because U does not intersect A. So A is contained in X minus U. And what is the definition of the closure? It's the intersection of all closed sets which contain A, right? That's the definition. So yes. There's one which does not contain X. So X is not in the closure. So this proves. Yeah, thank you. One is to concentrate on the logic and on the symbols and on the logic. So this proves, so U is neighborhood which dot, then X is not in the closure. So if X is in the closure, then every neighborhood intersects. So if X is a closure, then every neighborhood intersects. So this proves the other inclusion. I mean, yeah. Okay, so 2i, similar. So this is boring now. If you have a basis, then you do the same, but you do it with basis. So definition, and this is a very strange definition. But it becomes interesting now. So I'll start here. Limit point. So what is the limit point? Definition. By the way, we will come back next week to the product topology. The product topology here was very easy. But then we take infinite products, and then it's not clear. That's an interesting point next time. The product topology, but we take infinite products of infinitely many spaces, okay? Here we take two. With two, well, it's almost canonical. No, there is not much to say. But if you take infinite products, then it becomes very interesting. Next week. Definition. So A is subset of X. X is a topological space, as usual. Then X, a point X in X is a limit point of A. If every neighborhood if every neighborhood U of X intersects A, if every neighborhood U of X intersects A in a point, intersects A, that would mean X is in the closure, right? If I finish here, that means X is in the closure. Every neighborhood of X intersects A means X is in the closure of A, okay? And now a limit point, if every intersects A in a point different from X. That's a that's a very strange definition, because why limit? There's no limit here, no? But we come back to this point in two steps. First, we will consider in 5 minutes the Hausdorff condition, the first important condition for a topological space. And then in the second step, later, we need a second condition. And then we come to limit, but limit is not clear. The word limit, but it's a book, limit point, okay? We call it a limit point. But we don't see any limit. That we have to discuss. So, proposition, easy, proposition. So the closure of A is equal to A. What do you want? A union A prime. This is not so standard. So this is the set of all limit points. Set of all limit points. We call it A prime. set of all limit points of A. So we have this. So the closure, we take A and we add all limit points. So the proof is, again, very easy. Proof. So one direction is okay, no? Because we have A is contained in the closure always. And A prime is contained in the closure. This means every neighborhood intersects. So it's also the point in the closure. So this is clearly then that A, one direction, which one? A union A prime is contained in A closure. So this is immediate by definitions almost. And for the other one, so we have this, which one we have now? We have this one, okay? And now we need this one. So we take a point in the closure. So let X be a point in the closure. So here. And suppose X is not in A. Suppose X is not in A. So we take a point here, and suppose it's not here. Then we have to prove it's here, no? But if in the closure, then every neighborhood of X intersects A. That's why, because X is in the closure. So every neighborhood of X, that's a theorem, right? Every neighborhood of X intersects A. But X is not in A, so it's another point, in a point different from A, in a point different from A. Different from X, sorry. It cannot be X, because X is not in A. So then, this implies that X is in A prime. So it's a limit point. And all this together implies then that the other inclusion, so A bar is contained in A union A prime. So that's how to construct the closure. We take A and all limit points. We will see examples. Interesting examples. Because now the examples would be like analysis, okay? So I'm going faster here, because it's the formal part this week. Then we get interesting examples. And then we have examples of closure of everything, limit points and so on and so on. But first we have to do some formal theory. Not even theory. This is a language, definitions. Okay. So now I come back to this limit point. Limit point. So if it's a limit point, it should be every neighborhood intersects in some point different from the point. It should at least intersect in infinitely many points, okay? Otherwise, we have no limit. If it's just one point, it's very weak, but it's a limit point. So this is the first important condition, definition. A topological space is Hausdorff, it's a Hausdorff space. A topological space is a Hausdorff space if the following condition holds. So this is somewhat not immediately motivated here, okay? It falls from heaven, this definition at this point. If the following condition holds. So we define Hausdorff. The following condition holds. So what is the Hausdorff condition? This condition sometimes is called T2. But we don't say T2, we say Hausdorff space. T2 is very technical, but it's T2. Because there's T1, there's T3, there's T4, there's T0, there's T3.5, and there's a lot of T's. So this is T2, the Hausdorff condition holds. What is the condition? So, given any two different points, X different from Y in X have disjoint neighborhoods. That's all. Have disjoint neighborhoods. So the picture is the following. That's the Hausdorff condition. The picture is the following. Here's the picture. So we have two different points, X and Y, which are not equal. And then they have different distinct neighborhoods, disjoint neighbors. What did I write? Any two different points have disjoint neighborhoods. So here are the disjoint neighborhoods. This has a neighborhood, this has a neighborhood, and the intersection. So this is a T2, or Hausdorff condition. And T1, what is T1? So it's not important, T1. We see why it's not important, but we have also T1. And then we have an exercise. So T1 means any two different points, X and Y, each of these has a neighborhood which does not contain the other, but they may intersect. So this means, given X...
Single point is closed.
Sorry?
Single point set is closed.
Yes. So given X different from Y, each has a neighborhood not containing the other. And this is an exercise in the book. That's what you say. So exercise. So X is T1, if and only if points are closed. That's exactly T1. So it's not so important. We can say points are closed instead of T1. That's an exercise in the book. It's not in the text.
The camera is not moving.
Sorry?
The camera is not moving.
Here?
Yes, we can see that.
Do you see it now?
No.
You can't see that.
It's moving now, okay. Okay, it's good.
Yeah, okay. So X is T1 if and only if points are closed. So let's prove that. Every now I prove as an exercise, no? Proof, let's see. Or you want as an exercise? Okay. X is T1, points are closed. Let's if I can concentrate, I will do the exercise. This is an easy exercise, okay? Where is this? I didn't even write it here. So so proof.
You can take the union of all other point of all the neighborhood of other.
Sorry. Points are closed, finite subsets are closed. No, also, that's the same. So let me add that. Finite subsets are closed. Unions, finite unions of closed sets are closed. So finite subsets are closed. No proof. So suppose X is closed. X is T1. So I go from this direction. Points are closed. X is T1. What means T1? So it means let X be different from Y. Then, of course, not of course, then Y is closed. Points are closed, okay? Points are closed. So this is one singleton, one point set is closed, then it's closed, and then we have a neighborhood, and x minus y, so if you take the complement, this is the neighborhood of x, this is the neighborhood of x, it's open, it doesn't contain y, not containing y, it does not contain y. So this proves this direction, right? If points are closed, then X is T1. This is trivial almost. And then the other one, the other inclusion. Which one? This one. So now what we have to prove, X is T1, we have to prove that points are closed. So take a point, let X be an X. And we have to prove that X is closed, okay? The set X is closed. So let Y be an X, Y different from X. So I got lost. What we have to prove points are closed. X, the point X is closed, right? So if at any other point, then X minus Y, points are closed, right? Is that true? Yes. No. I have to prove points are closed. I got lost, sorry. I have to concentrate. 1 second. We have to prove that points are closed. So I want to call prove that this is closed, okay? That's what we want to prove. That's a claim. I'm getting tired, so this is closed. So what is the easiest way? So take a point in the complement. Let y different from x. It's not here.
There is neighborhood for y?
Yes, yes. We have T1, right? So there is a neighborhood of what? Of what is the best? Of
for of y.
Of x.
Of y.
Of y not containing x.
There's a name. The union of all such neighborhoods.
There's a neighborhood of y, a neighborhood u of y not containing x. And that means.
You vary the y on all y's that are different from x.
Why in the closure? So a closure means every neighborhood intersects x. so contains X, but there is a neighborhood of Y which does not contain X. So this implies that Y is not in X, right, in the closure of X. Yes. Y is not in the closure of X. There's a neighborhood of Y which does not intersect X, right? Because it's T1. So Y is not in the closure of X. So that means that the closure of X, what is that? It's X. There's no other point. So this means X is closed. Okay, so one has to concentrate a little bit. I hope it's okay now. Seems. So X is closed. So corollary, we are interested in Hausdorff spaces. So it means in the Hausdorff space, points are closed. Points are closed. Since, obviously, T2 implies T1. So in a Hausdorff space, points are closed. And we are mainly interested in Hausdorff spaces, not in T1 so much. By the way, we have 3 minutes and we have an example, an exercise, another exercise. So this is T2, this is T1, okay? And then we will see T3 and T4. So then somebody, maybe it's the same, it's not the same, and we have an example already. So, example. Let X be a set, be infinite set, an infinite set. With the finite complement topology, which we saw yesterday. With the finite complement topology. So we take a set, infinite set, with a finite complement topology. Then X is T1, but not T2. So it's not the same. That's just an example. That's an exercise. X, an infinite set with a finite complement, is T1, but it's not T2. The proof is, that's an exercise also. The proof is very easy. Hopefully. Then X is T1. So T1, what does it mean? So let X be different from Y, 2 points. T1 means we find a neighborhood of X which does not contain Y. Which is this? The finite complement topology. Then X minus X or Y. X minus, I want to prove, a neighborhood of X which does not contain Y. So X minus Y is a neighborhood. This is open because it has finite complement, which is just 1 point. So it's a neighborhood. It's open. It has finite complement. It's a neighborhood of X which does not contain Y. And this means that X is T1. Each point has a neighborhood which does not contain Y. So it's T1. X infinite we don't need here, no? In this direction, we don't need infinite. For T1. And now T2. Now the last thing is T2. Let's look at T2. the way, if we have a finite set with a finite complement topology, what is the topology then? Question. If we have
discrete
a finite
topology. Discrete topology.
Yeah, then it's discrete. And this is, of course, Hausdorff, okay? Discrete is Hausdorff, that's clear. Yeah, it's discrete, exactly. So we need infinite here. So let x and y be different points. Be different points in x. Suppose they have disjoint neighborhoods. Suppose x and y have disjoint neighborhoods. So let's suppose they have these non-neighborhoods, have disjoint neighborhoods. So neighborhoods, this is plural, so there's an s at the end. Suppose x and y have disjoint neighborhoods, u and v. Then x is equal to x minus empty set. Well, that's here. That's x minus, the empty set is the intersection of u and v, no? U intersection v. This is empty. X minus u. Now we have De Morgan, as usual. So this is x minus u. Union from De Morgan. So x minus intersection is the union of x minus u and x minus v. But we have the finite complement topology. So this is finite. And this is finite. So this all is finite. So this implies x is finite, no? So then x is finite. So if x is infinite, then x is C2. So x infinite then implies x is C2. Now that is the exercise. If it's infinite, then it's T2. If it's finite, then it's a discrete topology, and it's...
Sorry, X is not T2.
Not T2, yes, thank you. Exactly, that's what I want to prove. X is not T2. So this is an example of a space which is T1, but not T2, okay? It is T1, but not T2, exactly, okay? So it's not the same. Also, the T1 is, sometimes it's interesting, but we will not see it. But Hausdorff is important. Why? We will see next Monday. So what we have to discuss is the notion of limit point, and that's an interesting point. Here we get some important conditions for topological spaces, okay? So we see next Monday at 4. Are there any questions or remarks? It's too fast, maybe. There are not so many examples so far, but there will be examples, very interesting examples. At this point, we don't have so many interesting examples. We can do analysis, okay? But we will see very interesting examples, and then we have examples for everything, for the closure, for limit points, and so on and so on. And I mean, a large part of general topology are strange or interesting examples of spaces with some strange or interesting properties. And we will see at least 4 of these spaces. So Are there any questions or remarks? If it's too fast?
So for this week, our tutor will be just discussing the exercise or?
Yes, I gave two exercises, okay. I will give, I don't know, do you have the book? Can you get copies of the book?
We have a PDF copy, but it's not completely legal.
It's not what?
Completely legal. Yeah, we find it on the internet.
Well, so I shouldn't say anything about that.
Okay.
Because I will give you some exercises every now and then from the book. I don't want to write because then I take 20 minutes to write exercises. So I have to take the exercises from the book, okay?
Okay.
But then you need, yes, I will give you exercises which I find interesting, okay? There are many exercises in the book. And I will do some of the most interesting I will do in class. And then I give from the book some exercises. Next week.
Okay.
Okay, so we see next Monday at 4, okay? Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.